In this lecture, we will discuss capillarity and surface tension. So, we now know that in microfluidics, surface effects dominate compared with the volume effects, and capillarity or capillary effects are a class of surface effects which are actually prominent in microchannels. So, we all know that if we dip a capillary in, let's say, glass capillary in liquid, then that would result in a capillary rise, and the water will rise in the capillary and attain a particular height. Similarly, if you have a horizontal capillary where the gravitational effects are not important and you bring this capillary in contact with water, and let's say this is a glass capillary, then the water will invade the capillary, or we'll say that water imbibes into the capillary, and it will do so indefinitely. So these are the type of capillary effects that we see, and they occur only when we have channels of small dimensions. Now, to understand the phenomena of capillarity, it is the central idea is that surfaces exert forces. So this is the central idea that we'll focus, and this surface can be surface between, let's say, oil and water, that is surface between two immiscible liquids. It can be a surface between solid and liquid, or liquid and gas, and even solid and gas. Now, to understand surface tension, one way to understand surface tension is by studying the free energy. So, if pressure, temperature, and the number of molecules are kept constant, then, or if we are dealing with pressure, temperature, and the number of molecules, and these are our state variables, then we'll work with the Gibbs free energy. Or if we have volume, temperature, and the number of molecules as our state quantities, then we'll work with Helmholtz free energy. But in any case, the free energy is related with surface tension, and we'll see how. Now, the point is that a system having a particular surface will attain an equilibrium state such that the free energy, let's say the Gibbs free energy, when pressure and temperature are specified at a given pressure and temperature, is minimum. Now, the example of this system, or this process, is that if we take, let's say, water and we disperse an oil phase in water, and let's for the moment neglect the effect of gravity, then the oil drop will actually attain a spherical shape, and that is what we know from our physical intuition. Now, this is because the oil drop tries to minimize the Gibbs free energy. Now, the Gibbs free energy per unit area is actually defined as the surface tension, which we'll denote by gamma. So, gamma is del G by del A at by keeping constant pressure, temperature, and the number of molecules. Alternatively, we can also define gamma as del F by del A, where we have V, T, and N as the state quantities that are kept constant while taking this derivative. So the units of gamma from here we can see is energy per area, that is joule per meter squared, and this is the unit of gamma, and this is also equal to Newton over meter. Now, at fixed pressure and temperature, gamma depends upon the materials which are the materials or the phases which this interface is actually separating. So, gamma is a constant for a given choice of two materials which are being separated by this interface, and for fixed pressure and temperature the value of gamma is fixed. Therefore, the total surface energy is gamma times A. So if the system wants to attain fixed or if the system wants to attain the minimum surface energy, then it should minimize the surface area. So we know that for a given volume of this oil drop, the minimum surface area is for a sphere, and that's why the oil drop attains and acquires a spherical drop and a spherical shape, and that's because to minimize the surface energy. Now, to understand the origins of surface tension, let's consider an interface between a liquid and a gas, such as one shown over here. Now, in a liquid, if we have a molecule in the bulk that is far from the surface, then the molecule in the bulk forms bonds with the neighboring molecules, and these bonds may be non-permanent. And when the molecules form these bonds, it goes into a low energy state. But when you consider a molecule on the surface, so there are less number of molecules with which it can form these bonds, and therefore there is an higher energy of this molecule compared with the molecule in the bulk surface. Therefore, what we can conclude from this is that it costs energy to form a surface. So if you want to increase the surface area, it will cost you an energy, because the surface tension is always positive, and you'll have to increase the energy of the system and of the surface, and therefore you'll have to supply some energy or do some work. Now, an alternative interpretation of surface tension can be that surface tension is actually force per unit length. Now, this can be understood as follows. So, again, looking at this picture, now if we have a molecule in the bulk, then it is being attracted by molecules, other molecules in the liquid, equally in all directions. So there's net zero force on this molecule. But when the molecule is present on the surface, so for example in gas, there are no molecules that are actually pulling this liquid molecule. So there's a net force which is inwards, which tries to pull this molecule, and that leads to surface tension. So how surface tension is therefore given by force per unit length is, note that, let's say we have this frame, let's say a fixed frame, and this part of the frame is movable, and this is made of some thin wire, and we dip it in a soap solution, and there's a, let's say, soap film between this region. Now we apply, let's say, a force F. We'll use small letters F to distinguish from the Helmholtz free energy, which we denote as capital F. So the work done, let's say, if we apply this force and there's a displacement dx, and this is the length of the interface, then the work done is given by F dx, and this will lead to the increase in surface energy, so dg, and that is given by del g by del a times a, and this is gamma times, or del g by d times dA, and this is gamma times dA. So here we have two surfaces, because we have one surface between this film and, let's say, air, and another surface which is the bottom surface, and dA, that is the change in area, will be 2 times L times dx. So the factor of 2 comes because we have two surfaces, the top and bottom surfaces. So gamma can therefore be written as force over 2 times the length. So we can see that the surface tension is given by force per unit length of the interface. Now the typical values of gamma are in of order of few millinewtons per meter. So if we consider a water air interface, the surface tension is 72.9 millinewtons per meter. For mercury air interface, we have 486.5, and for ethanol and methanol, the surface with air, the interface separating ethanol and air will have a surface tension of about 20. So, with this brief introduction to surface tension, we look at one consequence of surface tension, and this is, so surface tension will lead to a pressure difference across an interface. And this pressure is actually called Young-Laplace pressure. Now to understand this, let's say that we have a spherical let's say oil drop in water phase, or any other immiscible liquid, or even gas. Now if we look at this particular section, so we have surface tension which is acting on the circumference . And we know that the force is given by gamma times the length, and in this case that is 2 pi times the radius r of this spherical drop. And there is a pressure drop to balance this this force, and let's say we have P O over here, which is pressure inside the drop, and PW, which is outside the drop. So this force is balanced by the force due to the pressure difference, which is delta P, the pressure difference, times the projected area, and that is pi R squared. So what this shows is that the difference in pressure is, in this case, 2 gamma over R, and because gamma is positive, so we have that the pressure inside the drop is higher than that outside. Now this relation is actually for a spherical drop, but we can generalize this relation for any curved surface in terms of the radius of curvature, and then we'll see that for a spherical surface we'll get the same relation back. Now consider a curved surface such as the one shown over here. So here's a differential element with sides dx and dy, and it's a curved element, so this radius of curvature is r2 along this y direction and r1 along the x direction. So the initial area of this surface is A equals to dx times dy, or we'll use delta x times delta y. Now let's imagine that we increase the volume, and that's due to displacement dz of this interface normally outwards, that would lead to this change in surface area. To calculate this surface area, we need to calculate these new sides and the side lengths. So from similarity, we know that because if you look at this curve and let's say this curve, they both subtend the same angle at the center over here. So from here, we know that dy, or delta y, over the radius of curvature r2 is actually equal to this new length. Let's say we'll call delta y nu, and that is equal to, so that is we'll divide it by the new radius of curvature, that is r2 plus delta z, because now the radius of curvature has increased by delta z. So delta y nu is actually 1 plus delta z over r2 times delta y. Similarly, we can show that delta x nu, that is the new side and length of this differential element, is 1 plus delta z over r1 times delta x. So the surface area due to this outward movement of this surface changes and becomes A plus dA, and that is given by 1 plus delta z over r2 times delta y times 1 plus delta z over r1 times delta x. So if we use this relation and this particular relation, and we neglect higher order terms, so we'll subtract this A from this A plus dA, and we neglect higher order terms, we'll see that dA is given by dz over r1, or delta z over r1 plus delta z over r2 times A. So this is the change in surface area due to outward movement of this surface by distance delta z. Now we can calculate the change in, or the difference in pressure. So if we neglect the influence of gravity, then there are only two contributions to the change in the total energy. So one way to look at this is that the work done, so let's say this is pressure, which, so this is side 1, which is inside, and this is side 2, that is outside the interface. So P1 minus P2 times the change in volume is the work done by the system, and that leads to an increase in the surface energy, and the increase in surface energy is gamma times delta A, and this is delta A, and delta V is actually A times delta Z. So P1 minus P2 is actually A times delta Z equals to gamma times delta A. So if we use this relation in this equation, get that P1 minus P2, which we'll call as delta P, is gamma times 1 over R1 plus 1 over R2. So this is one way of actually looking at what's happening at the equilibrium, that the work done is equal to the change in surface energy. There are many alternative ways, but essentially that you'll get the same answer. So you can also think like this, because when there's a change in when actually you increase the surface area, you change the surface area by, let's say, amount dA, then you are actually doing some work gamma dA, because this change in energy is due to this work done gamma dA. So the total work that is done by the pressure and the capillary forces is actually given by minus P1 times dV1 plus P2. So the total work done is given by minus P1 times delta V1 plus P2 times the change in volume of the outside medium, and that is, let's say, delta V2, this is minus, plus the work done due to the capillary forces, that is gamma delta A. Now we know that for displacement delta V1, the change in volume of this phase 2 is minus the change in volume is delta V2, and that is related to V1. Delta V1 by delta V1 is minus delta V2, and therefore the total work done by the pressure and capillary forces, if we do a differential displacement of this interface, is minus P1 minus P2 times delta V1 plus gamma delta A. So we note that in at mechanical equilibrium, this delta W should be 0, so we'll get the same relation that we derived earlier. Alternatively, you can think in terms of minimizing the energy and the free energy, and you'll get the same relation. So now we can note that for a sphere, the radius of curvature R1 and R2 are equal to the radius of the sphere. So that's why, using this relation, we actually get that the change in pressure across the spherical interface is 2 gamma over the radius of the sphere.